They've won Tonys and Oscars and Emmys and Grammys. There's no red carpet because they're home in their jammies. From Melrose Place to Broadway to Janeway and her crew, let Seth and James bring all the stars to you.
Anywho,
they're entertaining everyone, so who's gonna grouse? Just sit right back and you'll hear some tales on Stars in the
Hi, everyone. Welcome to Stars in the House. I'm James Wesley.
I have a frozen smile.
What?
Hi, everyone. I'm Seth Rudetsky, and we are in... Hold on. Can you see? This is Miss Richfield, 1981, and she always calls Provincetown, Provincetown, just for a stupid joke. So we are in, actually, Provincetown. Yeah, we've been here for the whole week. We're staying at the lovely Anchor Inn, and we're celebrating our wedding anniversary. Quick, James, how many years?
8 years.
Very good. Except for the pause. 8 years.
Well, because it's always, here's the thing. When you're gay, it's like, and marriage hasn't been around that long.
Yeah, we would have got married
earlier. It's like, you have to think, you don't automatically think, oh, how many years, you know? It's like, so we've been together for 14 years. Isn't that correct?
Yeah.
14 years, but we've been married 8. But yes, go ahead, Seth.
So anyway, we're celebrating here. Wow, is that a mosquito? Not cool. Anyway, so what is Stars in the House? You're axing. Stars in the House is a daily live stream we do for the Actors Fund. The Actors Fund helps anybody in the arts. So, you know, on stage, off stage, in front of the camera, behind the camera. Eon, Jack Plotnick. Why do people decide to text me after the show begins? The amount of times Jack Plotnick
has texted looking me for someone to distract you, whether it's a fly on the wall.
No, first of all, there's a crazy mosquito slowly walking, and then Jack Plotnick listen. Are we getting divorced after 8 years?
No, well, look at this great time we had yesterday. We have this great picture. So this is how we spent last night. This is like Liz's Cafe, and they turned the parking lot into this like amazing place to eat. And they have like these little igloos. It was really cute. And here we are inside it. So that's how we spent our anniversary, was in this little igloo. Seth, are you going to continue writing to Jack?
He's driving me.
You know what?
The wall.
Jack can wait.
Oh, yeah.
But anyway, as Seth was saying, this is for the Actors Fund. And yes. And if you are able to donate, please donate at
starsinthehouse.com and or you can text fundit2020 to 56512. And then you're going to get a receipt. Once you get the receipt, forward your receipt to donations at starsinthehouse.com, and then we will forward it to one of our stars here tonight, one of our Tony-nominated stars and our Tony-winning stars, like James Iglehart, and they will read it out loud.
Yes, I cannot believe this is the first time we began in mid-March, the first time, Seth, we've literally gone a week without doing a show.
Yeah.
Because our last show was Knots Landing, and then Annette Bening did Coastal Disturbances. Right. Thank you, Annette Bening. Brenda Braxton was brilliant, of course, as our Monday night guest hostess. Tuesday night was LA Theater Works, and Wednesday night, Sierra Boggess, thank you very much for hosting the show. And last night, we didn't have a show, and here we are celebrating the Tonys.
This is also what celebrities do. We actually both got facelifts. You know, it's the whole, we're taking a break for a week, but actually, we're not promised out.
So not true.
Or we're at Betty Ford for a rest. All right, what are you saying?
But, well, I was going to say, in the time that we've been gone, we are up to raise for the Actors Fund.
Yeah, it's been raising
$530,625 raised for the Actors Fund.
Iglehart's applauding. We can see him. And by the way, it sounds like a lot of money, but here's the thing. This money is going towards people paying their rent, their grocery bills, their health insurance, their doctor's bills. It's not a lot of money when you consider the amount of people that the Actors Fund helps, because they help people in every single aspect of show business. And
absolutely.
And that's just show business, just the arts.
Yeah, the arts.
Think of the amounts of people the amounts of live concerts and things that we've had canceled, but it's like the world, wedding singers, everyone has everything canceled, and especially health insurance is really running out. So the point is, it's a lot of money, but it's all gone. Everything we raise has been given out to everybody. So anything you could donate really will help these people that are basically living check to check.
Yeah.
What else do we want to say? Anything?
I don't think so. I mean, look, early voting, it's been so amazing, the number of people that have already voted. You go to startsinthehouse.com. We're working with Americans for the Arts, Arts Action Fund, and all of their information. You go to startsinthehouse.com for your state. I know a lot of registration deadlines have passed. Not all of them, but definitely, as we all know, proudly, wonderfully. So many people have already voted, so keep voting.
But if you go to starshouse.com, you will see the information for early voting.
State.
Yeah, it's so detailed. So it's right there, starshouse.com, right on the front
Absolutely.
Page.
And so while we were in Provincetown, we were able to watch yesterday our first guest, Tony winner James Monroe Iglehart, announced the nominations, which was so exciting. And you did such a great job, James. So let's just bring him on and we'll talk about it.
We want to talk about Tony nomination and him winning. And no, he was wearing a suit yesterday and he's wearing a suit again because he respects us so much. Look at the beautiful suit he's wearing. Not cool.
Well, listen, it's not that. It's just I've been in a suit for a couple of days doing different things. So I decided that, you know, you're so relaxed with your professionalism, Seth. And listen, Seth, the only time you actually wear a suit is when you're doing a concert. I mean, it doesn't matter. Even if your rehearsal, come on, let's be honest, Seth. Your rehearsals, you're in a t-shirt. You're ripping on us in a t-shirt. You're making videos in a t-shirt. You're ripping your husband in a t-shirt. I'm only ripping on you, Seth, because nobody rips on you. You get on everybody. I mean, from Patti LuPone down to Ian Armitage, you have ripped on the world and you always rip on poor James. James is there just working hard, sending out emails, being by your side. Come on, Seth. This is 8 years of marriage, 14 years of your life. You have a daughter who has a TV show on Playbill. Seth, be nice to the man. It's the anniversary. We'll talk about me.
Iglehart.
James Monroe Iglehart, if you were gay and you were not married to Don, I'd be marrying you right now.
Rude. Okay, I don't know what you want to say, Iglehart. First of all, this TV is very expensive. Then I'm
watching. Oh, God.
And by the way, second of all, usually I'm in a tank top, so it's actually
worse. That is true. It's actually really worse. It's
normally it's like this. So next question. Yeah. Okay, by the way, we love the room that you announced the Tony nominations in. This wasn't just set up for the nominations. This is like your showbiz room?
This is my room. Quick story. This was my wife's office, and we just redid it when we found out we had to do a bunch of stuff. But she was like, I want all your show posters on the wall. And I was like, babe, it looks like a freaking shrine to me, and it's weird because it's the guest room. And she was like, well, nobody's going to see it but me and the kids when they come over. And then COVID hit, and I had to do stuff. So I ended up taking over her office. So we had to buy her a brand new desk and all kinds of stuff and put her in the front room. So now it just looks like I like coming in here looking at myself. So
we had to I support to look all, look all.
Oh my God.
I love it. It has Memphis. It gives you street cred. Memphis. It does not have, however, the Wiz.
You know what? It's weird because I was 2009 and I didn't get a signed poster like everybody else did. Somehow I came to the last show late. I don't know what happened. Everybody signed their poster. I would have definitely put it on there. You know me.
All right. Well, so. Bravo for my eyes for realizing that poster is missing. I'm applauding myself for knowing your career so well.
James.
Yes.
It was so touching and moving. I think you were such the perfect person to do the nominations yesterday. It's like, What did you think when they asked you? Because I know, you know, Seth and I did the Drama Desk nominations way back in April, and one, it's an honor, something I never thought I'd be asked to do with Seth. But then on top of it, it ended up being an emotional thing, you know, because we read them live on the air. I mean, how was that experience for you?
It was definitely an honor, and I was so happy when I was told that I was asked to do it. And a couple things. One, from a community standpoint, I'm glad because I wanted to represent our community in the best way, and I wanted to also just, you know, I'm a happy-go-lucky guy. I always see the cup as, you know, half full, so I was hoping I could bring some of that to the table because our community definitely needs that right now. But secretly, I'm really trying to, like, you know, worm my way into the American Theater Wing and Broadway League because someday I want to be famous enough to host the Tonys. That is my goal. I mean, from the time I saw Rosie O'Donnell do it to Whoopi Goldberg, I want to host the Tonys. But I know I need a movie or a TV show or something real big to do it. And I understand that because, you know, Middle America only knows a certain part of Broadway. They know when they come on. But someday I'm going to be the brother. I hope I'm not too old where I like have to have co-hosts, you know, when you're so old, they bring you on for the first monologue and you don't come back to the end. No, I want to be the guy who like hosts the show. So when they ask me this, I'm like, okay, I'm one step closer.
Wait, A, you're an amazing host, but B, I do want you to be at the age where they make you do your signature song and you're like, friend, like me.
No, I do not want to do that. Where like, it's like, remember you when you sang the song on the CD and you have to sing it like two things down? Because you know the minute I host the show, that's when Seth will be MDing the show. So we'll be playing it way low and just like laughing. No. I'm hoping I'm young enough where I can like still sing the song and all, you know, we'll do a medley of all like the hit songs that I did, you know, Big Love and Friend Like Me and then What Did I Miss? And then David will come on stage and the audience will lose their mind. I've already got it planned out. I've really already got it planned out.
You'd be amazing because you're so quick in your feet because of all your Freestyle Love Supreme.
Trust me, in my head, I have the brothers from Freestyle in the show at, you know, different points. I was like, I think I know what I could do if they let me do this.
So now you've been on both sides. You've been the nominated side, and you were nominated for Memphis too, right?
No. Just Aladdin.
Wow. So the year you were nominated, you won.
I don't know the history, but I was told there's only a few times that's happened.
Wow.
So I feel like a few times, you know, within 74 years, but you know. Hey.
Exactly. Now, did you get the nominations in advance? How much knowledge did you have before they were actually posted? And did you want to call everybody?
I had 24 hours. So I got it. I got a Wednesday. So I
were you, was your hand like shaking on your cell phone? Just wanted to text everybody.
What's funny, you know, we had to sign an NDA, make sure everything was okay. So I just sat there quietly. My wife was like, "Are you okay?" I'm like, "Yep. Not gonna say a word." And what's funny is a couple of people texted me, you know, friends trying to find out. And also, you know, I know a lot of the nominees. So it's like, and some of the nominees happened to be in my benefit concert. So it was like, I'm giving out notes. I'm like, can't say anything to people. Ooh, have to be cool. I have Adrian Warren and I have Danny Burstein in my benefit concert coming up on Halloween. So
yeah, James, talk about that before you go. You got to talk about what that is.
Cool. Yes. So, okay. I have wanted to, people know I'm a huge Disney fan, and Nightmare Before Christmas is one of my favorites. And Raphael Cassell, who is the writer and star of Blindspotting from a couple years ago, a great film. He and David Diggs are really good friends. He and I had this idea about doing this concert. Well, fast forward to, you know, the pandemic and everybody's at home. And I was like, this is the perfect time to do that. And my wife and I were talking and we were like, you know, she went through Hodgkin's lymphoma in 2018. And I wanted to give back because you never know how you're going to react when someone you love gets hit with cancer. You don't know. You're always giving love and giving support over social media and stuff. But when something hits you, it becomes a whole different thing. And I said, great. So I contacted my friends and I said, look, I'm thinking about doing this. If you guys are down, let me know. And the first thing I had to do was contact Disney. And then we had to go through a bunch of stuff because, you know, Disney's a huge conglomeration. So we had to contact Tim Burton. We had to contact Danny Elfman. They all gave their blessing. Disney gave their blessing. And then I called the Lymphoma Research Foundation. And I also said, you know what? Let's call the Actors Fund. I want to call the Actors Fund because my friends are out there. My community's out there. So we all of the money that's being made is being split between the two organizations. And we have put no money into this. When I say, when you see our show, don't get me wrong, it's going to be professional, but we are wearing wigs and clothes from our house. Nobody bought anything. Everything they're wearing is in the house, and we are doing the songs virtually. So we have a narrator and just the songs. It's going to be a really fun concert, and the tickets are only $4.99, cheaper than a bag of candy. I really wanted people to be able to, if they were going to stay home and they couldn't go out trick-or-treating, spend money on this. $4.99, it all goes to the Lymphoma Research Foundation and the Actors Fund. And just to let you guys know, we have, like I said, Raphael Cassell. We have new Tony nominee, Adrian Warren as Sally. We have myself as Oogie Boogie. We have umpteenth time Tony nominee, Danny Burstein, playing Santa, as well as the narrator. We got Nick Walker from Ain't Too Proud, Leslie Margarita from James and C. and Matilda. We have Rob McClure from, you know, Mrs. Doubtfire. And then even my ensemble. My ensemble are not ensemble people. They were nice enough to do this for me. And I said, guys, if y'all ever need me to sing, you know, somebody does a favor and you go, okay, I guess I'll sing for you forever. So I have Catherine Allison from Company. I have Ginny Barber from All My Sons. I have Aaron Clemens from Hamilton, Fergie Felipe from Hamilton. I got Juwan Jackson from Ain't Too Proud and Brian Gonzalez from Aladdin. I mean, I got this. This is the cast. And also Jim Abbott, who's amazing, a musical director. He did the musical music for me. And we are going to have a ball. It's literally with story time with us. So it's a narrator and us doing the songs and we're out. It's a beautiful, quick night, $4.99. Money's going to a great cause.
And so, James, people go to actorsfund.org for that? Or yep. How do they get tickets?
Vimeo, yep. And they can pre-order tickets now or you can get tickets that night.
And it's going to be on October 31st, on Halloween.
Oh, yes, it's going to be on Halloween at 7 p.m. It's going to be on, so you can check it out. It's going to be fun. Trust me, these folks are singing. And they are, you know, when you look at the film, there's such these weird creatures, and you have these wonderful performers who can literally flat-footed just sing, looking as nuts as possible, and it's so much fun. I've been looking at footage all day. We're putting it together. It's going to be really good.
Great cast. And I want to just say two more things. So first of all, you and I are doing a concert together, and my concert is December 13th.
Yes,
December 13th. And that's a Sunday. It's going to be live. But I have a vague memory because I want you to do it in the concert. Didn't we once do the worst pies in London where you were Mrs.
Yes.
Lovett?
Yes, we did. Yes, we did. We did it. And you put me in I've been trying to find this video. You put me in the most amazing position ever. Ladies and gentlemen, I got to sing Worst Pies in London to Lynn Carreyrou, the original sweetie. Mm. You had him sitting down and I did the whole thing. Mm. I was living my life. And he didn't flinch. He didn't flinch. He actually acted like he didn't look at me like, oh, some crazy black dude's coming out. He literally just did. He played Sweetie, and it was like I walked away like, I just sang this song and they carry you. I was like, so this is twice. Now I realized at this moment that's twice in my career that I have sung a song made famous by another woman. So between that and Satisfied and I'm just like, so basically what we're saying is in 2022, Seth, I should just do all the songs by the women I love and we should just do a concert like that.
I'm available. I'm in the tank top. Okay. The final thing I want to show is this is the key when you host the Tony Awards, you're singing it in this key, girl. You ain't never had a friend.
Years later, can I make a joke? Now, years later, I can say this, like, because I didn't say it then, because I didn't want to bring attention to it. But I was not disappointed, but I was, you know, there's in rehearsal, I held that note out for days. And so when we're doing it, you realize, holy crap, we're Radio City. It's a Tony. I'm nominated. We're singing the song. And I was like, man, damn it. And I made the mistake. I made the mistake of like, you know, you want to go on and see what it looks like. And I go on YouTube and I watch the thing and I look at the comments like a stupid person. You should never look at comments. And everybody's like, oh my God, he's so amazing. Oh my God, he's so amazing. And then this one person, you know, like 5,000 people say you're great. And this one person goes, wow, really couldn't hold that note out. And it stuck with me for days. I mean, days. Oh my God. My wife was like, James, let it go. Like I had won the Tony. She was like, let it go. I was like, I couldn't hold the note out. It's cause that, you know, that's the Tonys. But now like every chance I get, I'm like, I take a big breath. I'm like, stop, breathe. This note's going out. That actor thing, when you hear those voices, I saw that. I don't read comments anymore, but I saw that one comment. Ooh, that got me for days.
Yeah, because Norm Lewis is mean. You should have told him not to comment like that.
How about Norm? You know what you did.
He's watching. All right, Iglehart, we'll see you. So October 31st, go to actorsfund.org. This concert sounds amazing. And then come see us December 15th.
And we're going to put it on our website.
Is it December 13th, I think, the 13th?
Yeah, oh, that's what it is. I don't know. December. You'll see us.
That second week of December, come see us.
That's right. Okay. All
Thank
right,
you,
Bye.
Okay, it's Tony night here in Stars in the House, and James has the schedule. Who the hell's next?
We have the producer of not just a Best Play revival, but a producer of Best Play. Please.
And by the way, I was arguing about the last name. I said it's Kirdahy. Oh. It's actually Kirdahy. Who the hell knew? Tom Kirdahy.
Hi, guys.
Hi, Tom.
First of all, Tom, why did I put an A before your last Y? It's Kirdahy.
Everybody puts the A there, and I never correct them. So you've been doing it for years, and it's all good. It's an extra syllable, you know.
So here's the dealio. You're nominated. Two of your plays are nominated. I think a lot of people are like, what does a producer do? Like, what does it mean that you produce these two plays so people that aren't so savvy about Broadway can understand what you did?
Well, the most obvious is raising the money, but it's putting together the creative team. It's curating the advertising and marketing campaigns and just sort of giving creative people a safe space in order to achieve their collective goals. I view being a producer as mostly staying out of the way and providing structure so people can achieve their wants artistically. It's tricky, but a lot of my friends call me the artist whisperer because I think I have a good relationship with artists. I think I understand how they think and what their dreams are and what they're trying to communicate. I think my goal is to help them achieve that.
Tom, were you the producer of the revival of Frankie and Johnny? It was like when I first moved to New York with
No, I wasn't. Joe Mantello, the Araka group, produced that. And I loved that production. I was a poverty lawyer. I worked with low-income people living with HIV and AIDS for almost 20 years. I had studied dramatic literature. So at the time of that revival, it was very early in my relationship with Terrence.
Oh.
It was one of our first openings together. So Yesterday was particularly meaningful to me.
Yeah.
If people don't know, Terrence McNally was Tom's late great husband. How many years were you together?
19.
I mean, how amazing that it was with our pal Audra being one of the stars. I mean, what was your experience with Terrence and producing Frankie and Johnny? Because that was last summer. I mean, it's been over a year.
It was the last Broadway production of anything of his while he was alive. And Terrence has a history of getting behind untested talent because he had great, great taste. And you hear it time and again. And Terrence had seen a production of Aaron Arbus's Othello, and he just thought it was dazzling and decided that she was going to direct the next production of Frankie and Johnny. He very much wanted a woman to direct it. And frankly, he always knew that Mike and Audra were the Frankie and Johnny. And it took us 4 years for their schedules to align. I mean, I remember I was speaking to Aaron Arbus yesterday. I called her to congratulate her on our revival nomination. And I said, I do remember once, Aaron, calling you in an airport and saying, now, don't hate me and don't panic, but we have to delay again. And I kept, every time I called her, I kept saying, like, the Tom Petty lyric is going around in my mind, stop dragging my heart around, because I felt like we were giving this woman her Broadway debut and it was delayed and delayed and delayed. But I will tell you, it was worth every second because from the first read through, we knew that Mike and Audra were Frankie and Johnny. And I have rarely seen Terrence so happy with a production. We really gave him a gift. So, you know, it's been a really terrible year. And I just wanted to say publicly to the two of you, thank you for your absolutely tireless contributions to all of us, because November 3rd is election day. It's also Terrence's birthday. And I am putting all sorts of unfair pressure on him to deliver good results. But really, I want us to give him a birthday present of a new president, a new administration, a new Senate, a new Congress. And I honestly can't think of two greater ambassadors for this community than the two of you. From the beginning, you've been raising money and making people laugh and providing joy, which is such a necessary respite as we wait for this, the assault from this administration on our dignity and on our families and on our industry is unconscionable. And, you know, for me, it's all so bittersweet, but yesterday's Tony nominations, it felt like we experienced collective joy for the first time in a long time. And I don't think anybody involved in the season or anyone in the community wants to be throwing confetti or to strike the wrong tone, because that's not what this is about. I think it's about resilience, and I think it's about our collective conscience, which is a we are wired to tell stories. We are wired to challenge audiences. It is incumbent upon us to make sure that in this moment, that the sort of the narrative of anti-racism is actually becomes a deep commitment, and that we don't go back to business as usual, that we really take all this pain and make it purposeful. It's just been the hardest year of my life. And I have looked to you guys and I've looked to this community, and I have to tell you, we know how much love there is in this community, but the strength that accompanies that love and the appropriate levels of rage. I've been reading a lot of James Baldwin, and love and rage are my engines right now. And I'm just filled with gratitude. I'm really filled with gratitude, but there's so much work that has to happen. And November 3rd is only a little more than 2 weeks away. And we need change. We need fundamental systemic change.
I love the idea when theater comes back to really, you know, add these changes we've all been talking about. And I just, we didn't even say it, the two plays that you were nominated for, Frankie Johnny and the Pierre de Lune and The Inheritance. Let's show, by the way, just The Inheritance, by the way, just because we got to give some shout outs.
Take your seat at The Inheritance and take a ride on the sensation critics are calling a blockbuster, a masterpiece. A raucously funny, Netflix-like binge of a Broadway show. A family of friends, hungry to conquer life in New York, but forging a future means facing truths from the past. Get ready for the roller coaster Broadway event of the year. The Inheritance. Get your tickets today.
Yeah.
How cool is that? Hey, Tom, check your... I'm about to... Wait, is this it? Hold on. I'm about to send you an email. Hold on.
Can you text?
Wait. Yeah, I'm about to. Hold on one second. Hold on. Actually, it was passive aggressive. The person that gets donations, but then didn't actually send that. Okay, so ignore that. Okay.
Let's talk about Matthew Lopez and that amazing company for a minute. I mean, when I read that play, I couldn't have ever imagined that. Matthew was a young Puerto Rican American who grew up in the Panhandle, who was 20 years my junior, and because it was my life on stage and all of its complexity. And what I love that Matthew did was connect the dots of history from E.M. Foster to a pre-Stonewall world to the height of the AIDS crisis, to gay marriage and forward. As I mentioned earlier, I had done HIV work as an attorney in the first act of my career. My second act has been producing, I felt that that play was the natural extension of everything I had ever done. And those actors, four of our actors are nominated, including the great Lois Smith. But that entire company was a group of marathon runners. They had to take care of their bodies and their minds, and in a way that was extraordinary. And it was a genuine privilege to give that company an opportunity to bear witness that the end of part one is one of the most extraordinary theatrical moments I've ever witnessed. And that's Stephen Daldry's direction was just beyond. But people would be sobbing in the theater, and the young members of the company in particular, witnessing what the audience experienced, said, I've read about it, I've heard about it, but now I feel like I've borne witness to it. The pain and the healing of the AIDS crisis and all those lives lost, the resurrection of their ghosts, their spirits, was brought to great theatrical life. And you know, I'm a really fortunate person to have been able to be involved with these two really beautiful productions that are all about connection, bringing people together and our aching need to connect with one another.
It was our last Broadway show that we saw, and you're right, the people all around us, you could just hear collective sobbing. Yes. And then lights came up and people were still sitting in their seats.
That was me.
Before we go to Dr. LaPook and our medical break, I just texted you some donations. Can you read them?
I sure can. Oh, this is great. Emily from North Carolina, $10. Kristen from Ohio, $20. Continually grateful for the light that Seth and James emit. That could be for me, but that's Mark from Massachusetts. Thank you for your recording of what the world needs now. My wife and I use that to enter for our wedding, and it brings happy tears every time I listen and watch your video. Keep up the great work from all the actors. Carol from Texas. So you're really all over the country, you guys. Happy anniversary, Seth and James. Joe from Massachusetts. Happy anniversary and endless thanks for your show, for giving everybody who's ever been a part of show business, even on the fringe, a reminder of the joy of what we're missing now, and for helping the Actors Fund to make such a difference in people's lives.
Well, thank you, everyone.
Thank you, guys. Happy anniversary, and happy 95th birthday to Angela Lansbury also.
Yes. Right? She stole a little bit of our thunder, but we'll take it.
Love wins. Love wins. I knew Seth pre-James, and I love the post-James Seth.
Thank you. You're so sweet.
We'll see you
Tony night virtually.
That's right.
Okay. Thank you. And by the way, give James the gig. He should host the Tonys. He's amazing.
I agree.
Amazing. I did not come on after him. I was like, I'm screwed. But he is, he's amazing. And again, bravo to you guys. Thank you for all of it, for just all of it. Bravo.
Thank you, Tom. You're so sweet. Thank you, Tom. Congratulations, bravo. Yes. I love that. Are we up to our medical
segment? Yes, we are. Let's bring on Dr. John LaPook.
Here he is, direct from CBS. Hi, Dr. LaPook.
Can you bring back Tom for 1 second? Is he still
Tom? You want to come on? 1, 2, 3, Tom.
Tom, hi. I have to say, I saw The Inheritance. It blew me away. I was one of those people nailed to the chair afterwards because I was an intern in March 1981 when I saw the very first AIDS patient. We called the grid, right? Gay related immunodeficiency.
Yes.
At Columbia. I can tell you where he was, first bed on the left in 8 ICU. And you know, I was a newly minted doctor, and I think I'm gonna be saving lives. And then every single person I saw who had that diagnosis for the next number of years died. Yeah. And then we had the cocktails and it became a more chronic disease. And I went into private practice and fade out, fade in. I saw the normal heart and I saw the inheritance and it all just came flooding back. Yeah. And I realized then that I had some form, whether it was officially, PTSD, but all of us at that time, we there was no in touch with your feelings in 1981. No crying in medicine.
Yeah, no, right.
No crying in medicine. We didn't have the right kind of counseling we should have had.
And John, I'll tell you, 1981 is the year I arrived in New York. And I remember that first, July 3rd of 1981 was the first article in the Times about GRID. And the character of Walter, played by Paul Hilton, that fabulous monologue where he talks about his arrival in New York. Oh, he arrives in New York in the summer of 81. So it was such a pivotal year for all of us, but there's all this unresolved grief that we all feel. And our hope was that we were providing some form of healing. My regret is that we didn't have tissues, branded tissues as merch, because we might have made some real money with that.
Well, but, you know, you should feel good, because your play and The Normal Heart made me insist, even though I was too old to go back on the COVID wards in April, supposedly, but I insisted on going back. And the main reason why I wanted to go back was to be able to talk to the interns and students and young residents and immunize them as best I could emotionally, about and tell them about me. And I said, look, this is big. I know you're in, like, you know, fight or flight mode. You're in emergency mode, but you've got to deal with this. And they are. They're so much better than we were. There are support groups. There's outreach from NYU Langone has outreach to the students and to the residents, and they're so much better than we were. And I'm hoping that, you know, I mean, there's no totally immunizing you. I mean, that's life in the big city. You're going to get upset, and it's going to come back, but. But you should feel good obliquely, because it really was one of the things that propelled me to go back in.
Thank you. And I have to say that you're a physician with an artist's heart, and it's really moving. And thank you. Thank you for your service and for helping the next generations, because God knows we need it. So
we certainly do.
Yeah.
Thank you, Tom.
Well, get rid of me. All right.
I love that you came back.
So, John, we haven't seen you in a week.
Yeah, man.
I'm here. Guess what? So I'm going to be on 60 Minutes on Sunday. The piece on Tony Fauci and his wife, who we interviewed too. It's going to be a side of him you have not seen before. Everything about, from what he thinks, what he thinks about the vaccines and opening up the country, but also some things you might know, like he and his family have had threats. He has to have federal security when he goes on a power walk, because he's had death threats, and you'll see the Brooklyn in him. You know, he's from Brooklyn. He was a 5'7" captain of his basketball team in Brooklyn. And he said he was very fast. But, you know, the Brooklyn comes out. Usually you see him calm and collected, and he is. But he was like, come on, give me a break. You're going after my family? You know, get a life. That's what he said, quote unquote, get a life.
Wow. I'm telling the truth.
Wow.
All right. Well, any updates? We haven't seen you in so many days.
We're spiking all over the country. You know, we're up almost the highs at the end of July. You know, the green, yellow, and red, you know, where green is okay, the state by state, red is danger, Will Robinson. If you look at a map of the United States, it looks like we're on fire. Yeah. And people have got to understand what is happening. It's like you closing your eyes does nothing. You know, the boogeyman is still there. Open your eyes and deal with what's frightening us. And that means you've been the best person at it, Seth and James also. Wear the mask, wash your hands, social distance, avoid crowds. Outdoors is safer than indoors. Ventilate, crack a window, open a door. These are the things, as we're waiting for the therapeutics to come in, the monoclonal antibodies, the remdesivir, all that to get sorted out as we wait for the vaccine, which is not going to be out until the beginning of next year, somewhere around there. We're not out of control. We can do all these things and make a huge difference. So it's cold weather. We're going indoors. The virus loves cold and dry. So this is the time we got to just redouble our efforts, even though we have COVID fatigue. We all do.
Okay.
We have one bit of advice from a listener. Yes. You need to get that on your business card, physician with an artist's heart.
That's a beautiful. If I had a business card, but it's right here. I don't need the card. It's tattooed now. It's a beautiful line.
He saw you. All right, so you'll be back tomorrow night for our second Tony Award night. So thank you, Dr. O'Neill.
Oh, one last thing. My son Noah said to tell you, he just showed me 5 minutes before this, Leslie Uggams singing June Is Busting Out All Over. He
said, come on, you're behind the times, girl.
No. He said, you've done a whole video about it, and that I have to tell you. So I'm telling you. I was in tears. I was crying from laughter. Oh my.
It is one. Yeah. Wait, so did you see when I deconstructed it with her next to me? Did you see that part of the video? You only saw her.
I saw when they did the subtitles.
Okay, well, I'm sending you everything. Goodbye, Dr. LePoke.
Bye. We'll see tomorrow night.
Oh, my God. That is like, you're behind the times, Dr. L. Yeah,
well, you know what? We're the ones who, like, watch Friends.
He's literally saving lives. I know, he's like, but he's also saving lives. I'm like, how dare you not watch a funny video? Okay, what the hell's next?
Well, she got a Best Featured Actress nomination in a musical yesterday. Please welcome Robyn Hurder. Hi,
Moulin Rouge.
Hi, friends.
Wait, Robyn, aren't you like fully blonde tressed in Moulin Rouge?
Guys, COVID pandemic. That's what happens. I grew her out. I grew it out and chopped it off. I obviously wear a wig in the show, but that wig is based off what my hair looked like when we were doing the lab back in, I don't know, 2000. It seems so long ago, but yeah, you know, why not? What do I have to do except, you know, do the Zooms now?
actually, that color looks great on you.
It looks beautiful.
Thank you. I always thought I was a dirty blonde, and then I found out because I started dyeing it when I was like 11 years old. So I figured out I was a brunette this year. 2020, full of twists.
Okay, so this is your first Tony nomination, right?
Yes.
I don't know. I want to make sure.
It's like, this is nuts. This is nuts. I am not going to try to sugarcoat how crazy I feel, and that this is out of this world, and I'm not on land yet. Like, I'm still really in a place that I'm not speaking well.
Well, normally you would be going to the show the night that you find out about the nomination, and you'd be celebrating with your cast members, and it would feel more real. And you, how do you celebrate something so amazing, but you're not with without your fellow cast members who help make it possible?
Yeah, it's a little heartbreaking. I'm a naturally positive person. I don't like to harp on the negative. This is obviously a strange situation. Today, just right before I did my sound check for this, Moulin Rouge had a huge Zoom cocktail happy hour party to toast everybody. And it was great to see everybody's faces, but it is extremely bittersweet. Today it really hit me that I was like, oh man, I just really want to go do the show now. Mm. Even though I really wouldn't be able to even fit into my costume. I couldn't.
I was thinking, like, how the hell do you like keep your extension up? Are you doing like Pilates and yoga every day? Or are you just
I can still do it, but I'm also sitting in a chair, and I'm also in pajama pants. I just gave myself out.
It doesn't matter. I'm so impressed. So look, people don't know what she has to haul out in the show. Robyn, here you are. You don't have to put on the red light.
Yeah, that would hurt right now. So you were
just marking, right?
Oh, okay. Marking.
First of all, I love Lily being dragged in a heel to go over to your arch. Is that hard to change your foot?
It is. It's funny. It's a little secret. So in the beginning of that when I get start getting like thrown around, I fall forward and these two boys catch me and they push me in the opposite direction. And I'm on top of my toes, which has made it very easy. I've broken in my boots to make them really go over, almost like they're like a point shoe.
Yeah.
But we realized in rehearsals for Boston that I was burning my toes. So we call the move matches because it was like my feet were literally going to light on fire. So whenever anybody's like, let's go for matches, because my toes are, I literally said, stop, stop, stop. And I said, Sonia, feel my toes. And there, you couldn't touch them because it was so hot. So now there's a suede cap on the top of the toes to stop from burning through the shoe. That's how intense.
I love that. B, I love that. I'm sure in the final published score, when the dance is broken up, it's going to say matches.
It's gonna say matches. Yeah, it's interesting. Yeah, because it was literally like my feet are on fire, being pushed in the opposite way, that friction. But yeah, I hate breaking in new boots, but I don't know, it takes a while. And I literally am just bending them in half, rubbing, like taking a rubber band and wrapping them in half, leaving them overnight so they can, you know, try to stay in this like cashew.
Permanent art.
Tail thing.
And the final question is, where were you when the nominations were read? What were you doing? Were you watching them? Did someone call you back?
Well, yeah, you know, I was reminded by one of my friends to repost something for a TBT on Instagram. And I saw that she's like, before the day gets crazy. And I was like, I was like, well, what's today? And then I realized, I was like, oh my gosh, they're going to announce the Tony noms. And it was like 11:50. So I went downstairs and I said, babe, to Clyde, my husband. And I said, we got to turn on YouTube. And I had no idea. I literally like was laying on the couch and I see them start reading the ladies from Jagged Little Pill. And I said, I hear they're and then as I said, amazing. I just saw the R and I literally like hurled myself up, gave the most guttural yell. I started like uncontrollably sobbing. It was just so visceral because there is not one ounce of me that thought this was going to happen. Like it was not in my mind. I mean, it was a moment. And my son Hudson, he's 6 years old. He was there and Clyde was there and we were just like all in a ball, like crying. And then my agent Ashley called and I'm just sobbing. I couldn't talk. And then my mom called and I couldn't even speak. I'm just crying in the phone. And it's just, it's literally just such a dream come true. This has been a goal of mine since I was 6 years old, ever since I saw Cats. I'm not kidding. And, it happened. So it's the past 48 hours have been, or 36 hours have been pretty crazy for me. I'm not really here yet. I will come back down to earth in a minute, but I'm still like floating in this euphoric dream. It's exciting. And it was such a beautiful, happy day for theater. Like we just, God damn, did we need it.
Yeah, it perked everyone the hell up. Absolutely. And you know, by the way, I love that you're both dancers. You know, I'm obsessed, I don't know if your husband told you, I'm obsessed with the end of On the Town Dance. Steps up for Tay. He's the only one who does a jeté and then literally flexes again in the air.
He doesn't have hips. I hate it. He's just like, he doesn't have hips. He's so good.
I can't. I want to see your son in ballet class ASAP. There's a lot of good genes there.
Well, yeah, he's a mess though. I mean, he's really good at soccer, but it's like you try to tell him to do anything and he's like, whatever, mom. He just does his own thing. When he asks me to go to dance class, I'll put him in dance class, but he's a sports guy.
Reverse apology, forbid him to go to dance class. All right, Lamy, thank you, Robyn. We love you.
Robyn, congratulations.
Thank you, guys.
It's our Tony Celebration Night, Stars in the House. We have two people coming up now,
That's
right?
That's right, from Jagged Little Pill.
Jagged Little Pill, with all those nominations, we have two different people. We have the orchestrator himself, who, by the way, is also a composer, Mr. Tom Kitt, his third appearance on our show.
Hi, Tom.
Hi, it's so good to see you guys.
And third appearance, and now we have three names. We have Sean Alan Creel. Hi.
Hi. How you doing?
Okay, what's happening? Tom and Sean, both your hair is like 7 feet in the air. Is that COVID style?
Well, mine always is. I just have, it's just, I don't know. There's, you know, who gets their haircut anymore? I don't know. It's just, it just keeps growing and growing.
I just got my haircut and have it.
You know, it looks amazing. You both still got it. So people don't know, Sean plays the dad in Jagged Little Pill, and Tom did the orchestrations. Now, what about the vocal arrangements? Did you do those too, Tom?
Yes.
But wait,
so great.
They don't have a nomination for vocal arrangements, do they?
They do not. No, but it's a skill that definitely would love for it to be recognized. It's quite an involved process and a very creative one.
Here's my new idea. So I was playing Oliver today, and Oliver was the last time a Tony Award went to a music director, went to Don Pippin. You know Don Pippin, who did Chorus Line and the Cottage, and he won the Tony for that. There's no more music director Tony. And then I was thinking, well, that's because now there's annoying, like, the music supervisor. But a part of me is thinking, maybe there should be a music department where we can combine orchestration with the vocal arranger, with the music director, because they're all together now, and I just feel like stuff's being left out. What's your take on it, Tom Kitt?
I think that's a great idea. I think it would take some figuring out, and the thing about, music direction, for example, to try to assess in any show, because every show is brilliantly musically directed on Broadway. So going and hearing it and saying what makes this Tony, more of a nominated show than that one. That would be the question of how you really assess, because again, it's like the most skillful, brilliant people are musical directing on Broadway.
Well, that's why I would combine it. That's why I would say, like, it's the conducting plus the vocal arrangement plus the orchestra, especially now with orchestrations. Let's be honest, orchestra's being cut down to 3 people. It's like, it's not the same thing when it was a delicious 24-piece orchestra. And yet the vocal arrangements, the fact that you had to take these Alanis Morissette solos and turn them into group numbers, that's such a skill set that I feel is being totally overlooked.
And people are excelling in vocal arranging on Broadway right now in such a dynamic way. So it would be wonderful to give a shout out to those brilliant artists.
I agree. I'm going to just show a little clip from Jagged Little Pill. Let's take a look, Sean and Tom.
Oh God, that made me cry.
So what's it like being inside that sound? You know, it's such a different experience to be in it. What is it like?
Inside that sound?
Yeah, you're part of it instead of watching the audience. Yeah, you're enveloped.
I can't even begin to talk about what Tom Kitt does. I mean, it's so freaking brilliant, and it's just such a joy and a pleasure to be inside that sound. I don't know how else to. It's complex and it's rich and it's so completely true to what Alanis originally wrote, and yet it's elevating it to this next step that the show is calling for. And I don't, Tom just listens. He knows exactly what's right, exactly what's not right, and it's as a performer in it, I'm always so appreciative of it, because he can always tell when it's not right. When it doesn't feel right, when I didn't feel comfortable doing something, he's like, wait, that doesn't, what can we do? What can we do to make that work? And it's just always such a relief and a joy to have such a collaborative process like that. But to be inside that sound, I mean, his arrangements for the show are mind blowing. So it's.
And Sean, where were you when you heard the Tony nomination goes to, like, where were you?
Oh, I went through the whole thing. I was just watching Robyn talk before us, and I'm right with her. I was just like, this is just mind blowing for me. So, I went through all of the, like, when I found out that it was happening on the 15th, that the nomination announcements were happening, I went through all of the steps. I went through, like, I'm going to pretend like it's not happening. I'm going to just wait until I hear at some random point in the night on Wednesday, I'll just find out, and then I just, and then I just sort of, like, I had my weird breakdown the night before, and I was like, no, I have to listen. I've got to listen. and then by the time I sat down at noon, I was like, okay, here we go. I just can't wait to hear what happens. Mm-hmm. And I was just, ultimately I just kind of just was so excited for whatever happened. I was just so thrilled that it's happening, that there's something in this crazy, dark, weird intermission that is bringing us all as theater people together again. I just think it's so necessary, and I'm happy it's happening. And I couldn't be more thrilled that I was nominated, but I have a feeling I would have felt the same even if I was. And I'm just so thrilled for everyone in my show that was nominated, everyone that was acknowledged. It's just exciting to have theater, down in front again.
I mean, Tom, you've been down this path with the Tony Awards. How does this experience feel so far compared to your past experiences?
Yeah, because Tom won for Next to Normal.
This is obviously an unprecedented time and a very, very challenging one. And I have Jagged Little Pill, which thankfully was able to open and be part of the season. And then I have Flying Over Sunset, which was about to begin previews on March 12th. And also at the Public Theater, The Visitor, which was going to start, which we were going to do our Zits probe.
And by the way, Almost Famous, which was supposed to basically begin as well.
Almost Famous, which was, we were talking about, you know, what the trajectory of that was going to be. And you know, I had a dream that the Tonys would happen when we could all be together in person, you know, and that would be a big cathartic moment for Broadway. Mm-hmm. And so I was with my wife and my son, who's on remote school. My daughter and my younger son are actually back in person, but my older son, who's beginning high school, so it's very challenging for him to have to try to meet new friends on Zoom. And we were in the kitchen, and I gotta say, when the name started, I felt this beautiful feeling of just seeing my friends, my colleagues, my peers recognize, seeing just what spectacular, brilliant work happened in the season and how it needs to be celebrated, and how, as Robyn said, as Shauna is saying, we need this moment right now to put theater back in conversation. And then to see the quotes that were coming out from how people were responding, speaking to how they're feeling in the pandemic, speaking to the need for us to come back, for art to be back in the world, theater to be back in the world. It just felt like a bit of normal, and a bit of theater was part of the conversation in a way that it hasn't been. And it felt urgent and comforting. And to get to see how Jagged Little Pill, the show that we just love so much, was recognized, and all the other shows that were recognized. So this is unlike any experience. And you know, even in this experience, you understand how special it is to be recognized with your peers, and to get to celebrate what we do. And so I feel a great privilege to be a part of that, and also in this crazy time to be pushing theater forward and putting it back into people's minds and saying, we're going to celebrate what we do.
Oh, and I guess before we go, we got a comedic edge. Sean, I feel like you were on SiriusXM and something horrific went wrong on stage. What, weren't you the culprit, or was it Derek? No, was it a Derek story?
Well, I don't remember anything going horrifically wrong. I think I told on Derek. I think he was, we were talking about, and I'm doing it again. Oh my God, here I am.
He tricked you, Sean. He tricked you.
No, it was something you had asked us, Seth, you had asked us something about one of the most embarrassing things that's ever happened on stage. And Derek was like, oh, I can't really remember anything. And I was like, I remembered something. Oh, it was when he called Bella Becca.
Wait, really? Catherine Gallagher?
Who's Catherine Gallagher's character. He was like, what about Becca? And everybody's like,
who?
Who's Becca? Derek has done that, I think, at this point, three times.
A new character.
I'm so evil for bringing it up. He's going to kill me. Oh, my God.
It's very necessary.
Don't tell anyone. Everybody, don't tell Derek.
Okay. It's just between us.
Yeah.
Sean, congratulations. Yeah. Tom, congratulations. Becca, congratulations. We will see you all Tony Award night.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
That's fine.
What about Becca? That's hilarious.
All right. Our final guest for tonight, and we are going to have part two tomorrow, including more of Jagged Little Pill, folks. We've got quite a few people from Jagged Little Pill coming tomorrow. But to conclude tonight...
And we're going to end with a song, by the way. We have a fun video song.
Oh, but we have the playwright of Grand Horizons.
First time turning on me.
That's right. Bess Wohl. Hi, Bess.
Hi, Bess.
Hi. Hi, guys.
Did I pronounce your last name correctly? Is it Wohl?
Yeah, it's Wohl, just like the walls. Oh, okay. Yeah.
I did Summerstock with Dana Wohl. Any relation?
No, there's all these walls out there, and I'm not related to any of them. I'm related to my parents, but that's it.
Good to know.
Well, congratulations, first off. Oh, my gosh.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
So what's your I Heard story? How did you hear the Tony Awards? Where were you?
You know, I was just listening to everybody's I Heard stories, which are so sweet. And I was too wimpy to watch. I'm just like too scared, too superstitious.
Yeah.
I was like, la, 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 la. I just couldn't be all. And then I actually thought it was going to be announced at 9 a.m. So I was like, okay, people will either be calling me at 9 or not. 9 a.m. goes by. Nobody calls me. And I'm like, all right, that didn't happen. I got a few little like texts from friends saying things like, how are you doing today? And I was like, oh, they're being nice, you know.
Dealing.
Like, how are you? Text. Fine. Uh-huh. And then I was in the, I went shopping. Like I was like, I'll do some shopping therapy. So I was in the changing room of Rag and Bone, like half naked. And all of a sudden, it's noon. And like my phone starts going crazy.
That was so funny. Wait, so you had the experience of literally thinking you weren't nominated and nominated. You got to literally have both worlds, like on one Lola run.
It was like a total roller coaster. And then I was like putting on my clothes in the Rag and Bone dressing room, like, oh, I gotta get dressed now. And I ran out of the Rag and Bone and I said to the salesperson, like, I'm not getting any, like, I'm not buying anything. I'm just leaving. They slide everything in there.
So exciting, man. You know, by the way, we love your cast. Did you think, you know, where I've known Priscilla Lopez for so many years, obsessed with her since The Chorus Line, did you ever think of her for the role? Did you flip out when she got it? Like, what was the deal with Priscilla? I love her.
I mean, she was like the dream for the, she's the dream for anything, but she was the dream for the part. And we were casting and we didn't know sort of what we were going to do with that part. And Mandy Greenfield, actually from Williamstown, said, you know, who would be amazing, but we'll never get her? Priscilla Lopez. And I was like, yes, immediately, call her immediately. And we called her and I mean, she said yes, which was so thrilling because she was just a joy. And she can still do that, you know, that number.
I saw that video.
Exactly. She did it backstage with Ashley. It was just like such a warm, beautiful group of people. It's cheesy to say because it was a play about a family, but they really felt like a family, you know?
Yeah.
And you know, everyone's always like, you know, when you go to the Tony Awards, you do the red carpet. Have they told you like what it's going to be like? Do you have to wear pants?
I don't think I do. Do I? I mean, I'm not wearing them now. Can you guys tell?
Who dressed your top? I mean, like, yeah, have they given you any information or just here's a nomination, peace out?
They, again, I am not the most reliable. I thought the thing was at 9. Like, I have information that I don't know I have. So with that caveat, I'll say, like, nobody seems to know. And, you know, I've been hearing, like, sometime in December. But it's definitely, like, we'll let you know when we know what we're doing. But I'm happy with the nomination. I'm just like you know.
The Tonys happen tonight at 7 o'clock.
It happened already. You were the Rag and Bone.
You were a target.
When I work with couples in my practice, we often start with just trying to make eye contact or hold hands.
Hold hands?
When was the last time you two held hands?
I don't think so.
I don't know.
Guys, hold hands.
Well, don't push them.
They can hold hands.
But they don't have to right now. Fear is normal.
Fear? I'm not afraid of it. I can hold anybody's hand.
Guys. Come on.
Fine. What do I care?
Okay. Well, how does that feel?
Fine.
Stupid.
Now, Nancy, if I were your therapist, which obviously... but I have done this a lot. I have helped a lot of people avoid a lot of loneliness and regret. So anyway, the next exercise would be for you to try telling Bill what you want.
I want a divorce.
Sums it up.
Oh my gosh. Daniel, so brilliant.
I mean, they really were. They just nailed it. They had so much heart and the timing of Jane Alexander's dry timing is just spectacular.
And Ashley Clark's fingers. so funny. I helped a lot of couples.
Bess, congratulations.
Thanks, you guys. Thank you so much. So nice to see you. Thank you.
Thank you for joining us
tonight. We'll see you Tony Award night, hopefully.
That's right.
If I make it. Yeah, exactly.
We'll make sure we tell you the time. Exactly. All right. We'll take that on.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thanks. Thank you. I'll be waiting by the phone.
Okay. Hello. Okay, so before we go, we want to read. We were going to show a video, but I just realized we're going to show it later in the week. So ignore that line that I said we're showing a video. We're not. However, we do want to read some of the donations that we got. Jimmy Wesley, I'll be the first one. Kathleen from New York, $15 for the Actors Fund. Thank you, Kathleen, my darling Kathleen. Isn't that a song? My darling Eileen.
Continually, how in the hell do you pronounce that?
Continually.
Grateful for the light that's nice. That's Seth and James Emmett, Mark from Massachusetts, $25. Thank you,
Mark. And this is very interesting. $100 from Patricia from Massachusetts. She says, Massachusetts. How do you say that? She says, donating in honor of Breast Cancer Awareness Month as a breast cancer survivor. Bravo, Patricia. Can't imagine not having health insurance. And that's what's happening to a lot of performers that's coming up, unfortunately. Yeah. We can't fix it. Can't imagine not having health insurance. So hopefully this will help. Please, everyone, get your cancer screenings. Dr. Lipuka's been saying that everything you've been putting off, do now.
Yeah.
You know, like colonoscopies, get that the hell over with. Get your cancer screenings. Also, she says, all capital letters, vote. I am 1 year cancer-free and have loved your shows. Thank you, James and Seth. Thank you, Patricia. And bravo on the cancer-free. And I agree.
Absolutely.
Get all of your screenings. In conclusione, tomorrow, more
we'll
Tony Awards.
Oh, my gosh. Can you name the people? I know Elizabeth Stanley.
And Catherine Gallagher.
Who in the heck? I know we're missing a lot of people. I think Blair Underwood is coming.
Yeah.
I mean, the list is a great one.
We'll be talking about the Tonys tomorrow.
Yeah.
Thank you, everyone, for donating. Thank you, Paul Cashy, for sending the donations. See all of you tomorrow.
That's right. Bye.
We don't have a closing song. You can do Dave when Tonys.
Oh, no. As long as you don't say anywho at this point, then I'm fine.
No,
I'll end broadcast, Seth, before you get to that part. I'm going to literally press end broadcast.
It's Seth and James.
No, yeah, go bring really slow so we don't get too. I can't.
You
no!
And
no,
everyone. So no. Who's gonna grouse? Just sit right back, and you'll hear some tales of stars in the hoose.
Oh, that's enough. Canadian broadcast.